Hello dear students, this is Rajesh Dadich, your mentor in English from Shiv Jyoti Educational Group, Kota. So how are you all? I hope you all are in the pink of your health, enjoying during this pandemic. So let's start.
In the pink of your health. So today we are going to start your chapter number 5, Indigo, from your book Flamingo, right? This is a very interesting chapter. And this is based on the days when India was struggling for its freedom. Yes, our national freedom. We were striving for. So many freedom fighters gave away their lives very happily for the sake of our independence. They died for the sake of us so that we may live very happily and as a free nation, free citizens. They wanted to see their nation free. They wanted to see us free, right? So, have a look at the chapter. This chapter, Indigo, was written by Louis Fisher. Louis Fisher, but before that, let me explain what the indigo is. Indigo is just a term that is used to give blue shade. Yes, this is a substance that is used to give blue shade to a white colors, right? At the time it was used as one of the dye colors, right? As one of the dye colors, right? So Louis Fisher wrote this chapter in the form of a small piece, means this chapter has been an excerpt from his main book, and the name of the main book is The Life of Mahatma Gandhi. You can see The Life of Mahatma Gandhi. The Life of Mahatma Gandhi. This book was so famous, or we can say whatever the book has been written on Mahatma Gandhi so far, this is the best book ever written on Mahatma Gandhi, right? And it tells each and everything about Mahatma Gandhi and all incidents and events related to Mahatma Gandhi, right? So have a look. So dear students, have a look at some difficult and important idiomatic phrases, and they are very much important. You know, these have been used in the chapter and they carry very important meaning and significant important. They have got urge the departure, means to request someone in a forcible way, right? To request someone to do something. So it has been used by Mahatma Gandhi in one of his speeches, that he would make a sincere urge to the English people, means to the Britishers who were in India, and they would be told to leave India. Harbor a man like me, means to give a shelter to someone. Harbor means to give a shelter to someone, right? Conflict of duties means confusion of duties. There is a confusion what to do and what not, means actually Mahatma Gandhi explained it to the Britishers that he was doing his duty as an Indian, and he was abiding by all the rules and regulations set by the English court, right? And seek a prop means to seek a supporter, right? So actually Mahatma Gandhi is saying that once a yeoman, a peasant under the name Rajkumar Shukla, a very thin and emaciated, very thin and weak person, a peasant, came to Mahatma Gandhi. Right, is Louis Fisher himself is saying, because he wrote the chapter, he is saying he went to Mahatma Gandhi, right, at his ashram in Sevagram in central India. He said, I'll tell you how it happened that I decided to urge the departure of the British. It was in 1917. Yes, this is the chapter written, means for the very first time Rajkumar Shukla met him in 1917. He had gone to the December 1916 annual convention of the Indian National Congress Party in Lucknow. Actually, when Louis Fisher met him for the very first time, Mahatma Gandhi went to Lucknow, had been to Lucknow to attend one of the Indian National Congress session, right? Okay, that was in Lucknow, and 2301 delegates, means representatives, big dignitaries, had attended that session. Mahatma Gandhi is recalling his, just remembering, and Mahatma Gandhi is saying, so at the time a peasant came to me looking like any other peasant in India, poor and emaciated. Emaciated, dear students, What is emaciated? Quite thin and weak, right? As almost all Indian farmers were. They were poverty stricken, they were very poor, and they were fearful. Means they were afraid of the British, right? And said, and this person gave his introduction to Mahatma Gandhi that he was Rajkumar Shukla and he was from Champaran, right? Champaran is the place that is situated, that is located on at the foothills of the Himalayas on the Indo-Nepal border, right? And he said Gandhi had never heard of the place. When he said that he was from Champaran, Gandhiji, for the very first time he had heard this name. So he was not familiar with this name, Champaran. So it was in the foothills of the towering Himalayas near the kingdom of Nepal, already explained. Under an ancient arrangement, the Champaran peasants were sharecroppers. And when Mahatma Gandhi asked him, why you want me to go to your place? He said that we seek help from you. I want you to be with us and share our problem regarding sharecropping, indigo sharecropping, right? Rajkumar Shukla was one of them, and means he was one of the victims. He was illiterate but resolute, as and he had come to, and he was over there to Mahatma Gandhi. He wanted him to go with him. So dear students, have a look. Mahatma Gandhi told Shukla that he had an appointment and he was very busy, and sometimes he had to go to Kanpur, he had to go so many places to attend different sessions, including Kolkata also. At the time Calcutta was there. But that person Rajkumar Shukla seemed so resolute, very adamant he was, and he was after Mahatma Gandhi. Yes, he had, it seemed that he had decided to take Mahatma Gandhi to his place. So anyhow, come what may. So then Gandhi returned to his ashram near Ahmedabad, and when Mahatma Gandhi said that once I have to go to my ashram, thereafter I'll seek my appointments, and then only I'll give you any kind of appointment. So wherever Mahatma Gandhi went, that Rajkumar Shukla also followed him everywhere. It means he was resolute kind of person. Shukla followed him to the ashram. For weeks he never left Gandhi's side. Fix a date, please fix a date, every time he was requesting Gandhi. And now this man, means Gandhi, was so much impressed with his tenacity, with his firmness, that he just agreed. And story, Gandhi said, I have to be in Calcutta on such and such a date, and come and meet me and take me from there. Now Gandhi agreed, Mahatma Gandhi agreed, and he told him that once my session at Calcutta is over, you may take me to your place from there. Okay, so months passed. Shukla was sitting on his haunches, means to sit on legs, waiting, eagerly waiting for someone at the appointed spot in Calcutta. When Gandhi arrived, he waited till Gandhi was free, and right, he was eagerly waiting for Gandhi to be free. Then the two of them boarded a train for the city of Patna in Bihar. Yes, at the time only trains were there, and for the very first time Mahatma Gandhi was going over there, you know, Champaran, one of the places in Bihar. And Mahatma Gandhi for the very first time had heard of this place, right? There Shukla led him to the house of a lawyer named Rajendra Prasad. When they went over there, then Rajkumar Shukla took him to the place of Dr. Rajendra Prasad. You know, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, who later became the president of Indian National Congress, as well as later he became the first president of Free India, right? So Rajendra Prasad, who later became president of the Indian National Congress. So dear students, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, you all are very much familiar with them, right? So he was the first president of Free India, you can see. But unfortunately at that time Rajendra Prasad was not there, so his servant was there, and he knew Rajkumar Shukla, because frequently this Rajkumar Shukla met Dr. Rajendra Prasad to seek his help. That's why he was very much familiar with. But when he saw Mahatma Gandhi, and for the very first time he saw him, so he did not recognize him. So he did not allow Mahatma Gandhi to enter, and even Rajkumar Shukla and Mahatma Gandhi were not allowed to draw water from their well, because he was of the opinion that these were poor peasants and the whole water of the well would have got contaminated. That's why this treatment they got, right? So they were allowed to stay outside only, but Gandhi was not permitted to draw water. As I have told you, Gandhi decided to go first to Muzaffarpur, right, which was en route to Champaran. En route to Champaran, en route means on the way to Champaran. So Gandhi wanted to go to Champaran first to collect information, to obtain more complete information about conditions than Shukla was capable of imparting. Means whatever the information Rajkumar Shukla had given to Mahatma Gandhi, in Gandhi's opinion, that was not enough. So Mahatma Gandhi wanted to collect some more information about this so-called sharecropping or Rajkumar Shukla's problem. Right, so Shukla was capable of imparting. He accordingly sent a telegram to Professor J.B. Kriplani of the Arts College in Muzaffarpur. Once Mahatma Gandhi met him, so he sent information to him, whom he had seen at Tagore's Shantiniketan School in West Bengal. Right, so dear students, Mahatma Gandhi went to J.B. Kriplani's place, and Kriplani was waiting at the station with a large body of students. They were so much excited that a person, and nobody knew except Kriplani that this person was coming. So Gandhi stayed there for 2 days at the home of Professor Malkani. That was a great job for Malkani, because he was a government teacher, right? And at the time he was about to give shelter to a person who was just trying to do something against the British rule. So it was just equal to a crime, but still he collected, he mustered up courage, he was brave enough. So Malkani, a teacher in a government school, and it was an extraordinary thing in those days, Gandhi commented, for a government professor to harbor a man, what I told in the beginning, to give a shelter to a man like me, means I was just going to do something against the British rule, and if the British rule came to know of it, they would punish Malkani. But still he gave shelter. Despite all these things, he gave shelter, right? So the news of Gandhi's advent emergence, when Gandhi turned up there, this news spread like fire. Advent and of the nature of his mission spread quickly through Muzaffarpur and to Champaran. Sharecroppers from Champaran began arriving on foot, and means they were collecting, they were coming to meet Mahatma. Who is this person, strange person under the name Mahatma? Oh ho, it means he has come to give us some kind of support, he has come to help us. So they were very exciting, and they were very excited, and they all wanted to meet Mahatma Gandhi. So anyhow, whatever the management they could do, means anyhow they managed to reach Mahatma Gandhi by their own vehicles or by on foot, something like that, right? Muzaffarpur lawyers called on Mahatma. They met Mahatma Gandhi to brief him, to give brief detail. They frequently presented peasant groups in court, and they told him about their cases. So when they told everything, they told about the system, the atmosphere at that place, so Mahatma Gandhi grew angry, and they scolded them. Mahatma Gandhi scolded the lawyers for collecting fees. What's wrong with you? You being Indians, you are collecting, you are charging high fees from Indians, so what good we can expect from you? In this way Mahatma Gandhi lost his temper, and he scolded them all, right? And he said, I have come to the conclusion that we should stop going to law courts. Mahatma Gandhi was of the opinion, now it's of no use going to some courts for any kind of help, because we Indians are taking advantage of other Indians, so it's of no use, we won't get any kind of judgment in our favor, no justice would be made like this. So he was of the opinion that only one solution is there. What solution was there in his opinion? That first of all, we have to make India free from fear of the British people. Second, poverty stricken, so somehow we should try to improve their economic condition, right? So he was saying fear stricken people and it's of no use, and the real relief for them is to be free from fear. First of all, these people are to be fearless, right? Most of the arable land, arable means fertile, very fertile land, right? In the Champaran district was divided into large estates owned by the Englishmen. Means most of the people's land, means farmers' land, had been captured by these so-called landlords, Indian tenant landlords or English people. So the chief commercial crop was indigo, and they were forcing these Indian peasants to grow more and more crops. And what was the crop? That was indigo. In this way, they were minting money from Indians. The landlords compelled the all tenants to plant 3 tanks, means 15% of their holdings with indigo, and surrender to entire indigo harvest as rent. Means they had captured their land and they wanted Indian peasants to work on their land, and in return they would, what will they grow? They would grow indigo. Indigo is very harmful crop, and that can change all fertile land into infertile land, means barren land that grows into, right? So in return, they were supposed, Indian peasants were supposed to give 15%, that was around whole crop of indigo, and this was the system. And in this way they were taking advantage of Indian, they were exploiting Indian peasants, right? Presently the landlords learned that Germany had, somehow the British people came to know of this synthetic indigo. Now at the same time, in parallel, one more indigo was there, and that was developed by Germany. And when these British people came to know of that, they got scared. Means they had a doubt whether they own their real indigo would go in the market at the same price or not. So they came to a conclusion. What? Germany had developed synthetic indigo. They thereupon obtained arrangements from the sharecroppers to pay them compensation for being released from the 15% arrangement. So they forward it a proposal in front of the Indian peasants that if you really want to be free from this so called 15% arrangement, what you will have to do, you will have to compensate us. So you just give us a certain amount, and in this way you will be free from this arrangement. So this compensation, and most of the peasants had already signed the agreement because they were illiterate, but Rajkumar Shukla, like some peasants, did not sign that, and that's why Rajkumar Shukla wanted to seek help from Mahatma Gandhi regarding this arrangement, right? He did not want to sign this as a compensation to the British. What wrong with them? So the sharecropping arrangement was irksome. Irksome means troublesome. That was giving trouble to the peasants, and I told you so many of them had already signed, but Rajkumar Shukla and some others had not signed. Meanwhile, the information about synthetic indigo reached the illiterate peasants. So when most of the peasants had already signed, thereafter they came to know of this synthetic indigo, and they also went against the British. They also wanted that whatever the amount as compensation they had already given to the British, they wanted it to be back as a refund. They wanted the refund, right? So at this point Gandhi arrived in Champaran. Like avatar, Mahatma Gandhi, like a savior, right? So he began by trying to get the facts. First he visited the secretary of the British Landlords Association. So Mahatma Gandhi wanted to get some more information about that, and that's why he decided to go and contact this office. So dear students, when Mahatma Gandhi reached that office, the secretary over there, he did not behave well with Mahatma Gandhi, and he just gave a flat refusal he gave to Mahatma Gandhi, that we cannot leak out the information to an outsider. Mahatma Gandhi was shocked. What rubbish are you talking about? Do I look like an outsider? You people are outsiders. I am an Indian. India is my land. How is it possible? I am not an outsider in this way, right? Next, Gandhi called on the British official commissioner of the Tirhut division, in which the Champaran district lay. So Mahatma Gandhi decided to contact this office that was in Tirhut. Tirhut is one of the places in Champaran, right? So the commissioner, Gandhi reports, Gandhi is saying that the commissioner proceeded to bully me and advise me forthwith to leave Tirhut. Now this place also was not good for Mahatma Gandhi because he was not given good response from these people. And on the other hand, Mahatma Gandhi was advised to leave that place as soon as possible. In this way, Mahatma Gandhi grew adamant. Why should I leave? I am a free Indian and I can move about anywhere I like. So Gandhi did not leave, but instead he proceeded to Motihari, the capital of Champaran. At that time, Champaran's capital was Motihari. Several lawyers accompanied him. Accompanied means to go with. So many people, so many lawyers went with Mahatma Gandhi over there. At the railway station, a vast multitude of people, means so many people in large number, collected over there to welcome Mahatma Gandhi. He went to the house and took a stay at a place, and thereafter they were chalking out the whole plan, what they were supposed to do in future, right? So they were just discussing. All of a sudden they came to know information. What kind of information? An information was there that a peasant was maltreated, was behaved very brutally by the British people. So Mahatma Gandhi decided to contact that person, to call on that person as soon as possible. That's why Mahatma Gandhi just started on an elephant to meet that peasant, right? Gandhi decided to go and see the next morning, and he started on the back of an elephant. He had not proceeded so far. So when the police superintendent, but Mahatma Gandhi was on his way while riding the elephant, all of a sudden he was stopped by an English officer, and Mahatma Gandhi was said that he was to be back, and Mahatma Gandhi agreed, right, students? So Mahatma Gandhi agreed and he went back in his carriage, and over there the messenger drove Mahatma Gandhi home, and over there Mahatma Gandhi was given a letter. A letter was there, and in that letter it was written that Mahatma Gandhi was supposed to go back. And very politely, in a very humble way, as Mahatma Gandhi was, he wrote that I do disagree, I defy your order, I don't agree. And in this way Mahatma Gandhi signed the order in disobedience. In consequence, Mahatma Gandhi received a summon, means an official order from the court to be present, right? So Mahatma Gandhi received this summon, right, dear student? This is an official order from the court to be present, right? So all night Gandhi remained. Now Gandhi was in tension because he was supposed to be present in the court just the next day. So he was just taking a meeting, serious meeting was going on with some of the influential people. Means Mahatma Gandhi wanted to discuss all pros and cons of the matter, and Mahatma Gandhi was discussing with them. Suppose everything was uncertain because Mahatma Gandhi didn't know anything of that. So Mahatma Gandhi was telling them if anything wrong happened to him, what they were supposed to do regarding this project in future, in his absence, right? So Mahatma Gandhi could not sleep the whole night, and he telegraphed Dr. Rajendra Prasad to come from Bihar with influential friends. And in this way he sent instructions to Ashram also. He wired means to send telegram. At the time, in olden times, wired word was used. In Hindi they used to say tar, right? So he wired a full report to the viceroy, means he gave each and every information to the viceroy of that time. Morning found the town of Motihari black with peasants, means they were protesters, they were opposing each and everything. Means a person from far off land had come to give them his help. He was ready to fight for them, and in this way he was supposed to be present in the court. So they all grew angry, and as a protester they were present over there. They had merely heard that a Mahatma who wanted to help them was in trouble. How is it possible? If somebody is helping us and we cannot let him go like this. So they were giving him support, indirect support. They are spontaneous means natural, right? Natural demonstration in thousands around the courthouse was the beginning of their liberation from fear of the British. Means this was the first time when these so-called Indians seemed to be free from the British fear. Earlier They were fear-stricken, but now somehow they were mustering up courage. Okay, students? The officials felt powerless. Now it was the first time when the British people felt helpless because of this vast multitude, as opposers means demonstrators were there, right? They felt helpless. Okay, helpless means powerless. Without Gandhi's cooperation, they requested Gandhi to manage everything, to control them. He helped them regulate the crowd. He was polite and friendly as Gandhi was, so he supported them ahead. He controlled these peasants. He was giving them concrete proof that their might, hitherto dreaded and unquestioned, could be challenged by Indians. And indirectly, Mahatma Gandhi told them that whom you were thinking afraid of them, whom you were thinking could not go against you, now they were rising and they were ready to go against the British people. So it is better for you to change yourself and go back to your land. The government was baffled. The government was quite confused. The prosecutor requested the judge to postpone the trial, apparently. Means clearly the authorities wished to consult their superiors. Then Gandhi protested against the delay, means some kind of delay was there. So Gandhi did not want this delay and he wanted judgment then and there. So he read a statement pleading guilty. He was saying that he really felt, he admitted that he had committed a crime in the eye of British constitution or British law. But he said that he was in dilemma. He wanted to be a survivor, means he wanted to a supporter of Indian tenants because he was Indian, and he wanted to follow, he wanted to abide by the English rules and law. He did not want, Gandhi said, he did not want to set a bad example before as a lawbreaker. He did not want, he used to respect law also, but he said, I wanted to help my nation also. Right? So, but in obedience to the higher law of our being, the voice of conscience, he asked the penalty due. And the magistrate announced that he would pronounce sentence after 2 hour recess and asked Gandhi to furnish bail for those 120 minutes. Means the magistrate said that I would be back after 2 hours. So, till then, you may undergo the formalities for your bail. But Gandhiji bluntly refused. I have not committed any kind such kind of crime. So why should I go for my bail? No, he refused. Right? When the court reconvened, means restarted, the judge said he would not deliver the judgment for several days. Meanwhile, he allowed Gandhi to remain at liberty. To remain at liberty means he wanted Gandhi to go for anything, means he was free to do anything, but within limits. Right, students?